Let's continue our discussion regarding experimental design and data collection by talking about sources of error. Now, when you go out and collect data, the true value of an object being measured can be represented as the actual value. Okay, this is the true value. And it's going to be equal to the individual measurement. That's what you measured when you went out and made contact with this item, person, whatever, and collected the data. So it's the result of your individual measurement plus the bias, if it exists, and plus the chance error. Now, I want you to think about this simple example. It's something I like to do in my classes, is I have students go out and measure round objects, maybe a dime, a quarter, a nickel, a basketball, a baseball, a tennis ball, a telephone pole, a clock, you know, whatever, a bunch of round objects. And what they're going to measure is the circumference and the diameter. So for right now, let's just talk about the circumference only. Let's talk about just a measurement of the circumference. Someone goes out to a clock. It's a nice round clock. They pull it off the wall. And all they have is a string, perhaps, and a one-foot ruler, 12-inch ruler. That's it. That's the tools. All the tools are allowed. So maybe they wrap the string around it and say, okay, that's where it ends. Pull it up, put it on the ruler, and say it's X inches. Okay, that's the individual measurement. That's what was actually taken. Now, there could be a bias. And there could be chance error involved in that. So, we're going right now talk about the idea of bias and chance error. But I want you to, in your mind at this point, just think about what the individual measurement actually is. And let's keep this idea of measuring round objects for a moment. We use that as an example throughout this particular discussion. Now, the bias is a systematic tendency of the sample to misrepresent the population. The population would be all objects that are round. Well, there's like billions and billions and billions of round objects, right? So you could take a sample, because you can't possibly do a census, and from that you're going to measure all these, you know, the circumferences and diameter. And in case you didn't already realize where we're heading for this, if we take the circumference divided by the diameter, that's that magical, beautiful number pi. What we would do in class is see if we can't, by measuring circumference and the diameter, and recognize the fact that there is different types of error involved in the measurements, how good of a job can we do in actually estimating what pi is? Pretend for a moment that you don't know pi. It's something that's mystical. You think there's some type of relationship between the circumference and diameter of a circle. Don't know what it is. Okay? Now, again, back to the idea of a bias. A bias sample is one that is falsely taken to be typical of the population from which it's drawn, but it's not. Now, in our circular example, you go out and you measure the circumference, and you use a string, you put it on a ruler to measure the length. If every time you did it, you always rounded up to the nearest eighth inch or nearest quarter inch, you're producing a bias. Okay, you are overestimating every single time. You are systematically, there's your systematic tendency, you are systematically reporting something bigger than what it really is. Okay? If you always round up, or round down, if you always round down, then again, it's a systematic tendency to underrepresent. So that's the idea of a bias in a particular measurement. Now, chance error, commonly referred to as random error, the first thing you need to understand regarding the chance error is that the chance is a result of the measurement process, not the object being measured. It's the process. Well, on this string, if you take this clock and run the string over it, put it on a ruler, and measure the circumference, then give it to somebody else and they do it, they're going to come up with something probably slightly different. Chance error is simply as a result of the process that you're following, not what's being measured. Now, let's take another example. Suppose you're going to go out and contact a bunch of people on campus, and you're going to ask them to answer a survey for you. You got like three or four questions regarding the price of books at the bookstore or something. And let's just say that you have a bias against a particular ethnic group. You don't like Hispanics or blacks or whites or Asians or Pacific Islanders. Or pick one and just pretend like there's one of them that you have an issue with. Well, when you go out on campus and you take your survey, if you avoid that particular group because you have this personal racial prejudice, that's producing a bias because you're systematically eliminating that particular group. That is a result of what's being measured, not the process. The process is simple. You walk up to somebody and ask them questions off your survey. But it's because of what you're measuring and your particular bias toward that, or a particular ethnic group, that you're creating a bias in your sample. Now, chance error has a tendency to bounce all over the place. It would overestimate on this one, maybe underestimate on another. It just kind of moves around. There's no systematic tendency to either over or underestimate. If the bias is zero, the chance error over and underestimating, because it bounces around, we should get a pretty good average or typical measurement or approximation of what the actual value is. But we need to be able to identify any possible biases, control for them, eliminate them, if at all possible. Okay, in the next video, we're going to talk about different types of designs in order to design an experiment, conduct an experiment, and actually go out and collect data.